When we arrived, there was someone or something waiting for us. But it wasn't vile. It was shaped like a man, but dark, with eyes like holes into nothing. He had a sword, and as we lay there, it laughed and tossed it through the rift we'd come through. Craving mortal souls, the horned Prince of Bargains sought out the legendary witch named Rare. He wanted this sword to be devilishly mischievous, imbued with ancient pagan magics. He found the hag in her secluded lair. His trusty canine sidekick likely advised against this plan. But what did the mutt know of power? He would always be subservient to his master. Clavicus Vile had been right in trusting this ancient witch to provide a potent enchantment for his new blade. But he hadn't anticipated just how powerful this enchantment would be. The sword was magnificent, jet black from tip to pommel. The sorceries flowing through the blade could rend the souls from its victims, revoking their right to a peaceful afterlife, filling a soul gem. However, to Clavicus Vile's displeasure, there was a stipulation, one that did not favour the Daedra Lord of Pacts. While typical enchantments simply required a mortal's soul energy or life force, Nain Rawair demanded something much more significant. A piece of Clavicus Vile's own divine power was needed to stabilise the sword. Vile's sphere of influence includes trickery and dodgy deals, which makes this exchange painfully ironic. The piece of Vile's essence implanted within the sword actually made the sword a sentient being, which called itself Umbra. The sword wished to be emancipated from its creator, and actively worked against the weakened prince. The witch cackled with delight at her successful ruse, and some say the witch was never truly a witch, but a disguise donned by the mad god Sheogorath. For who else coveted mischief more than Clavicus Vile? Enraged, Vile executed the wretched witch. But he was too slow, as she had just enough time to hide the evil creation from the prince. Though sentient, the Umbra sword was still confined to the limitations of being a sword, and so it waited patiently for a worthy wielder to come along, a treasure seeker or a curious traveller, a mortal who would be susceptible to Umbra's gradual corrupting influence. All the while, Clavicus Vile retreated to his realm, the Fields of Regret, nursing his wounds, reeling from his embarrassment, rueing the loss of his power. Vile knew his own nature. He was ambitious, acquisitive, and fond of deceptions. And these very traits would work against the prince, as he was now being antagonized by a figment of himself. When Umbra was created, this was undoubtedly Vile's greatest fear. Could Umbra grow more powerful every moment it was hidden from him? Could he be defeated by his own creation? Welcome back to FudgeMuppet, ladies and gents. My name is Drew, and after a brief hiatus, it's time to blow the dust off the stack of Daedrology tomes looming in the corner of my room at the College of Winterhold. Because today we're diving back into the Plains of Oblivion, specifically Clavicus Vile's Fields of Regret. In this video, we're going to learn all there is to know about one particularly determined Daedric artifact, an artifact that gained sentience and strived to be freed from its master. First of all, let's not go calling anyone Umbra. There is no Umbra. This thing that suffers from the delusion that it's its own person is actually nothing of the kind. Do you understand? No more than a stone rolling down a hill is capable of self-locomotion, or an abacus of doing math by itself. What was in this sword was me, plain and simple. If someone cut your leg off and the leg started calling itself Umbra, it would still be your leg, wouldn't it? You wouldn't humour it, would you? Help it out with its delusions of grandeur. Clavicus Vile may have a vested interest in preserving his reputation and quelling any rumours that he had grown weak, but that did not dispel the reality that Umbra was a sword-shaped thorn in his side. When the ancient witch transferred a fragment of Vile's power into the sword, it obtained the necessary sapience to choose its own name. Why Umbra? Well, the word Umbra in our universe translates to shadow or ghost in Latin, and that name was fitting because the sword was truly the host to a dark spectre that would eventually try to take a humanoid form, which could wield the Umbra sword and depose Clavicus Vile once and for all. However, it wouldn't be easy to achieve this form, as Umbra needed more of its master's power. In its current form, Umbra could shapeshift, but only into other bladed weapons. As a result, whenever it has been spotted on Tamriel, it has been described in different ways. Some say it is a black and silver claymore, while others would attest that it is a jet black longsword, or a black sword emblazoned with red markings. Whatever kind of blade it was, Umbra was an exceptional weapon, a prize for any mortal unlucky enough to discover it. The first of these beholders was an orc warrior dwelling in the mountains of the Ascadian Isles region of Vardenfell. Sadly, his true name is a mystery, as the orc took on the name Umbra when he found the sword. Either he was so fond of the weapon he found that he felt it warranted a change in identity, or the sword infiltrated the orc's subconscious mind before taking control and using the warrior like a marionette. The orc apparently had a burning desire to die in battle, for he'd grown tired of life and of slaying so many foes with his Umbra sword. He finally encountered a challenger capable of besting him in combat, the legendary Nerevarine. It seems as though the sword's new owner did not hold onto it for very long, as it was discovered soon later in the hands of another warrior 6 years after the orc's defeat. The Nerevarine was evidently too strong-willed to capitulate to Umbra's corrupting influence. A young Bosmer named Lenwin, residing in the quaint little Cyrodiilic village of Pell's Gate, was the next to claim the Umbra sword. She had been fond of battle, and was the apprentice of a local Nord barbarian named Irok the Wide. When asked about his former student, the Nord appears sullen, suggesting the girl named Lenwin was no cold-blooded killer, at least until she found the black sword. It's a powerful sword, no doubt about that. Jet black, got a wicked edge on it, and they say it can steal a man's soul. I know of at least one soul it stole, Lenwin. She's the one who found the blasted thing. Who is Umbra? I can tell you who Umbra used to be. Lenwin. She's my apprentice, or at least she was, until she found that sword. Never did say where it came from. She just showed up with it one day, said it was called Umbra, but she was different. She'd always been fair with a sword, but she began looking for fights, became bloodthirsty. I fear that girl is long gone. If you seek her out, take care. She's a powerful one, or at least that sword is. I'd steer clear if I was you. Just like the orc warrior before her, Lenwin's mind was corrupted by the sword. However, the Bosmer showed admirable resolve, resisting the sword where she could. She may have given in to its power, becoming another nameless slave at Umbra's mercy, but she still seemed remorseful for her deeds, and locked herself away in the Aelid ruins of Vindazel to prevent further casualties. If adventurers come across her deep within the ruins, she warns them to stay away, saying, "Get out of here while you can. The blade, it hungers for souls. Umbra, it is everything. Umbra shall feed." The young mercenary was eventually put out of her misery by the champion of Cyrodiil, who was on an errand from Clavicus Vile. Vile had finally discovered the location of his stolen power, and was desperate to have Umbra return to him. Barbus, ever the level-headed canine companion, cautioned the champion against bringing the sword to his master, as he could foresee the ruin it would bring to the prince. But Vile soon got his way, and the sword found itself in the hands of its creator. The Umbra sword had finally garnered enough attention to find its way back to the Fields of Regret, and now the stage was set for it to carve away the additional power needed to free itself from the limitations of being a blade. It's difficult to say whether Clavicus Vile was being naive, he does often manifest as a youngster after all, or whether he simply underestimated the sword, but whatever the case, the Umbra sword capitalized on the first possible opportunity to escape from Vile. And in doing so, it swung its edge at the prince, lopping off another chunk of power for itself. Immortal power pumped through the sword, which the living entity within devoured. Umbra was now fueled with enough godly vigor to take on its own form, and it took the shape of a dark being, vaguely reminiscent of a man, but veiled in shadow, with eyes like holes into nothing. Umbra was free, and what's more, he could still use the Umbra sword. Clavicus Vile, in a hurried attempt to prevent Umbra fleeing the Fields of Regret completely, changed the walls of his realm, essentially trapping Umbra inside. However, this wouldn't be the end of the pursuit, as Vile was no longer searching for a sword. This was a powerful entity now, with all the parts one might consider vital to autonomy, like two legs and two arms. Umbra evaded Vile, concealing himself in one of the cities at the very edge of the realm. The Fields of Regret resemble tranquil countryside, dotted with majestic cities of glass and ornate buildings. Here, the Scarfin, a race of horned humanoid Daedra, dwell in relative peace. Relative to the vast majority of Daedric realms anyway. The plain is filled with lush forests, picturesque lakes, and mountain ranges. One could easily mistake it for the Clovian highlands of Cyrodiil, at least they could if it weren't for the shards of golden metal and stone spirals floating listlessly in the skies above. All in all, Clavicus Vile's realm was full of hiding places, and I imagine Vile was fighting the urge to raise his realm to the ground in frustration. With his power cut away and stolen by Umbra on two separate occasions, I wonder if he even had the strength to do so at this point. These were desperate times for the Prince of Pacts. While all of this was unfolding, back on Tamriel, the city of Vivec was experiencing strife of its own. For centuries, sorceries cast by the demigod Vivec had been preventing a huge meteor named Bardal from crashing into the city. But since his disappearance, the magic has been gradually weakening. In order to keep the rock suspended in the air, two Dunmeri engineers named Sul and Vuhon created a device called an Ingenium. The device was powered by a steady influx of mortal souls. And of course, where there are souls at stake, Clavicus Vile was involved. By making a pact with Vile, the two Dunmer got a functioning machine. In return, the souls used for fuel would funnel directly into the Fields of Regret. At first, any old captured souls sufficed, but that did not last for long. Next came prisoners and undesirables, until eventually, powerful souls were used to keep the Ingenium running for extended durations. Sul's lover was even sacrificed by Vuhon, but the machine was destroyed when Sul tried to save her. Bardal plummeted toward the city of Vivec. The ensuing calamity triggered the eruption of Red Mountain, and thousands were killed. The aftershocks of this catastrophe are still being felt to the present day in Morrowind. Anyway, just like his master, Umbra was attracted to the influx of souls coming from the rift in Vile's realm caused by the Ingenium. Umbra anticipated that the rift would widen just enough that he could throw the Umbra sword through it, putting a great distance between Vile and the sword. When the Ingenium was destroyed, the rift gaped open. Umbra tossed a sword to Mundus, and the two Dark Elves responsible for the rift, Sul and Vuhon, were sucked into the Fields of Regret at the same time. Umbra learned of the Ingenium's power, the way it could keep huge pieces of land suspended in the air. Seeing an opportunity, he took the two engineers captive. And like his master, he quickly elected to propose a pact. Vuhon would be spared a grisly death, so long as he built Umbra a new Ingenium. It was done. One of the cities on the outskirts of Vile's realm was ripped free from the soil by the new Ingenium, and this floating landmass was called Umbriel. Umbra and Vuhon were fused together, and their joined soul powered the machine. Some years later, the floating city was called to Tamriel by the Hist, and Umbriel finally escaped from Vile's realm. The fusion of Umbra and Vuhon, which we will call Umbriel, feared that the Umbra sword could be used to trap Umbra once more. However, without the sentient soul of Umbra stabilizing the sword, it drove whoever touched it instantly insane. Vuhon's old partner Sul located the sword, and was able to wield it without completely losing his mind. He used it to teleport to the Fields of Regret, where he met with Clavicus Vile. The weakened prince snatched the sword from Sul, driven by his desperation. But without Umbra, even he could not tame the sword. They reached an agreement. Sul and his new partner Atrebus would free Vile's lost power from the Ingenium in return for passage to the Imperial City. After returning to Tamriel and infiltrating the city of Umbriel, Sul battled Vuhon before the Ingenium. The soul-stealing power of the sword was obsolete against Vuhon, whose soul was in the device already, but the blade remained sharp. They battled before Atrebus plunged the sword into the Ingenium, splitting Umbra from Vuhon, and trapping Umbra within the sword once more. Vuhon was mortally wounded by this separation, and with the veil protecting Umbriel destroyed, Clavicus Vile entered the city. After being stabbed by the Umbra sword, Sul threw his impaled body into the Ingenium, turning both him and the sword to smoke. The artifact was seemingly destroyed for good. The city of Umbriel retreated back to Oblivion, and Clavicus Vile reclaimed his lost power. This was believed to be the end of the Umbra sword, and of the entity called Umbra. It disappeared for close to 140 years, but in an astonishing twist it resurfaced on Tamriel. And by astonishing twist, what I actually mean is a new piece of lore created by the Creation Club. Yes, I spent $10 to get enough credits to own this sword in Skyrim. It would seem Bethesda are just as good as Clavicus Vile at making favourable bargains, because I personally would have preferred for the story of Umbra to end with the destruction of the Ingenium, and for my wallet to be $10 heavier. But here we are, when an Imperial treasure hunter fell down a hole in the mountains east of Shorestone in Skyrim, breaking both of his legs in the process. He discovered the Umbra sword. The Imperial, formerly called Cresitus, began calling himself Umbra, and he lurked within the ancient arena of Champion's Rest, waiting for wanderers to find him. Then he would claim their souls for the sword. The last Dragonborn was one of these wanderers. Only he slew Cresitus and took the Umbra sword, claiming it in order to prevent it falling into the wrong hands. One question remains. Did Clavicus Vile truly recover all of his lost power? If he did, we can hope the Umbra sword will remain subdued, posing no further threat to mortals or its master. But if its corrupting influence persists within the sword, as Cresitus's tale would suggest, we may not have seen the last of this dangerously ambitious sentient sword. And there you have it, guys, the Umbra sword, a fascinating weapon, one that came frighteningly close to overpowering its creator, showing a troubling glimpse of the true potential of Daedric artifacts. Thanks so much for watching, guys. I hope you enjoyed the video. I've been Drew the Daedrologist, and I'll see you next time.